Did you know you can add extra data to your tilemap tiles? Custom tile data can be very useful to make the tiles you place affect the gameplay of your game. Using them, changing gameplay elements of our maps can be much easier. For example, if I want to change this conveyor belt, I just need to paint it over the map, and now the items will now flow to a new direction. One common use for custom data is making your tiles change the speed of units over them, such as water tiles that make you slower and add some effects. You can get creative and add all sorts of effects to them. So, let's see how it's done. To add extra data to your tiles, first we need to create it inside our tile set. So select one of the tile map layers, open up the tile set resource on the right, and expand the custom data layer section. Here's where we can declare the extra data we are going to give the tiles. Let's make the water tiles affect the movement speed, so let's call it tile speed and select the type of data as a float value. Now, open the tile set bottom panel, and click on the select tab to allow us to change the tile values. You can now click to select any of the tiles, so let's select our water. We can see our tile speed data inside the custom data section, and when we click on it to change its values, now all tiles will display their tile speed values. Let's set the water tile speed to 0.5 for 50% of the speed, click on the deeper water, and set it to 0.3 for 30%. Alternatively, you can also click on the paint tab to apply the values to multiple tiles at once. Just select the paint property to the custom data tile speed, set the value you want, and now you can click and drag over the tiles to paint that value to them. To actually use the custom data in our code, we will need to access our TileMap layer somehow. You can do that in any way you want, but here I'm going to use groups. Groups are an easy way Godot have to give you quick access to nodes. Select the ground TileMap layer and click on the node tab. Make sure groups is selected, and let's create a new TileMap group. You'll now see this icon, meaning this node now belongs to a group. With that done, let's create our player script. Select the player and create a new script. We'll start with the basic movement script template, and change its code so it works for a top-down game. So we remove the gravity, add an up-down movement to it, and reduce the speed a bit. Now, let's create a function that returns the tile speed of the tile the player is on. We are going to use this value, so we can multiply the player's velocity. First we get our TileMapPlayer node by calling the getFirstNode in group, and getting the group named TileMap. And if we don't find it for any reason, we just return 1, to keep the current speed. Next, we need to get our tile data. We need two steps for this. First, we get the cell index that is under the player, by calling tilemap.localToMap and passing the player's position. This will return a vector 2y with the xy index position of the tile the player is on. And we get our tile data, the tile itself, with getCellTileData and passing the cell index. If you are using the old tilemap node, before Godot 4.3, you also need to pass the layer's index to get the cell tile data. But then, if we find the tile, we can get our tile speed with the getCustomData tile speed. And if that is higher than 0, the default value, we return it. If not, we just return 1 to keep 100% speed. Now all that's left is multiplying our velocity for the tile speed. And we are done. We can place water tiles on the map, and the player will now move slower on them. We can now change the water tiles anywhere, and it will automatically affect the player, with no further changes needed. But what will happen if you have multiple tilemap layers and some of your special data is inside another layer? You could give each of them a different group name and get the tile data from a specific group you want, but that is not ideal. Also, having to repeat the same type of code for getting the tile data is not very good. So let's make some improvements. We can change our getTileSpeed function to get a generic getTileData function that accepts a tile data name and returns the data. So using it is as simple as calling the getTileData and passing the custom data name you want. And we now check for the default value outside of it. But how do we deal with multiple tile maps? What if we want to put the tiles on the overlay map and have it still work? Here's one solution. We can now put all the tile map layers inside the same tile map group, and now, instead of getting the first node in the group, we get a list with all of them. And then we reverse that list. This way, top layers will have priority. If there is a tile on them, and they have the data, bottom layers are ignored. Then it's as simple as iterating over the layers and trying to get our tile data. If you're curious about the item's conveyor's belt, here's the code. It uses a vector2 custom data named tileSpeedChange that tells the arrows where to push the items, or the player. I've made the arrows with the ground push it very slowly. The ones that use transparency for putting on the overlay layer, I've made them push much harder. I should have probably made them red too. Then I used a tile-based friction to stop the item's movement. Basically, while the item is on the conveyor belt, The items will slow down at different rates, just so I can control it to make sure it ends on the center of the next arrow. So if the arrows move the items very fast, I would set a very high friction, so it stops before being pushed out of the arrow. I also added a way for the player to push the items here. So using this system, I can now just paint push tiles into the tile map and have them immediately affect things in the game. But that's it. A very quick overview on how to use custom data for your tiles. I hope this video helps. And until next time.